I'll give you the lunch ticket after a while. Okay, I got this turned on, so. All right. I said I got it turned on. I guess I got it turned on. Green light's on. Okay, Titus chapter number 2. There it is. Hey, oh, all right, Titus chapter number 2. Someone asked me why I didn't preach more in these meetings. It's because we've got so many guys that can. Years ago, I would go to a meeting and I would have maybe somewhere between 9 and 12 sessions over a weekend, and there'd be me and one other guy, and he wouldn't preach but once. And I would do all the rest. I was a lot younger then, and I talked a lot faster, too. I could get a lot more in. And then eventually we began to have guys. I used to pray, Lord, give us some preachers that can preach this message. And not just know it, love it, stand for it, but preach it. You know, and I thank God that we have that now. And it's an exciting thing to me. I wouldn't even have to speak in a meeting like this, and it still goes great. In fact, the meeting in Ohio, Edwards told me they blew the doors out this year. I wasn't there. And that's a good thing. And I'm grateful for that. That, to me, is probably one of the greatest things. And the fellowship we have with these fellows, the preachers and the teachers, and everybody that goes through the school doesn't want to preach. But, you know, no preacher ever had a desire to have anything more than a bunch of guys that work with him who are edified, established in the faith, and had a understanding of godly edification, and had that working in them. And that makes you a perfected saint who can do the work of the ministry. And it's just a privilege for me to be a part of that and to be able to fellowship with people and these brothers from all over the country. And you won't hear anybody as they preach that, you know, any of them. I just say, thank God for them. And I'd be happy to give my slot to any of them any time. But I'm not. I'm going to preach myself tonight. So I get to preach Sunday night, and and I'm going to talk tonight about, in the theme of what we're talking about, the idea of a renewed mind giving you a renewed hope. And I want to talk to you a little bit tonight about bringing grace to life, putting it into not just a theology. Grace is not just a doctrine to be believed. It's not just a theology system to be adopted. It's not even an education concept simply to be grasped. Grace is a life. It's a life-transforming truth. And if it ever becomes just a doctrine to you, or it ever becomes a curriculum to matriculate through, and you miss the fact that it's designed to be life, then you've missed what grace is really all about. Titus chapter 2 is a passage, verse 11 and following is a passage. It's one of those little capsulizing passages that Paul is noted for. There are many places in Paul's epistles where he will take and just sort of, in just one short little verse or a couple of verses, just encapsulize and crystallize into just a few clear words a tremendous amount of truth that he's communicating. And Paul, you know, it's fascinating to me, when you read Paul's epistles and just read them over and over and over again, you realize Paul didn't think you had to say everything every time you said something. And a lot of preachers don't get that. A lot of preachers think every time they say something, they've got to say everything about that particular issue. Paul didn't do that. He expected his hearers, his readers, to grasp what's going on and to be able to have understanding about these things and to plug in that information. And every now and then he'd put these little passages together that just sort of brings all this stuff together and goes, boom, there it is. And the clarity of it is really startling. One of my favorite verses like that's over in Colossians chapter 2, verse number 7. And I'm not going to teach that tonight, but just as an illustration. Here's a passage like that. Verse number 11, Titus 2:11. Now, he's been giving them instructions about what they're to be doing in the local assembly. Back in verse 1, he talks to, but speak those things which become sound doctrine, that the aged men, he talks about them. Verse 3, the aged women. Then he talks about the young women. Verse 4, then he talks about the young men. Verse 6, then he talks about servants in verse 9. And the whole gist of all that he tells them is there at the last part of verse 10. He says that the doctrine of God, our Savior, that they might adorn the doctrine of God, our Savior, in all things. So the whole issue in the local church is all these different people groups in the assembly are to be working together, and the goal is that the truth of God's grace would be adorned in the lives of that assembly, put on display. And then he says in verse 11, 4, here's the explanation for what I just told you. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. Let no man despise thee. Don't give anybody any reason to think poorly of you. You take that book and make it the issue, and these things speak. This is what you're to talk about, Titus. You're to exhort. You're to tell people, hey, let's get on with the program. And you're to rebuke. You're to say, that's not the program. And you're to do it with all authority. Where would authority come from? Come out of that book. You know what that book is? That book is the only absolute moral authority in the universe. Because it's the word of the only absolute moral authority in the universe, the Creator. You're to teach that book. And you're to teach these truths with authority. When I first moved to Chicago, I was preaching at North Shore Church. And I was, after we had sold the old building, we'd moved out and were fellowshipping with another assembly, Norwood Bible Church. And there was a brother in that assembly, who was Brother Ed Erickson. Alex, you remember Ed, and some of you will. And Ed used to call about every 6 weeks. He'd say, Rick, would you come and let's go to eat lunch together? And Ed had a tremendous ministry at the Chicago Gospel Mission, where they had it called the Scripture Kids. He had about 100 kids from the inner city who he taught scriptures to, and he'd stand up and just quote, call a verse, and they'd quote it, call a verse, they'd quote it, call a verse. They didn't know what he was going to call, but they knew he had to have 300 scriptures memorized to get in it, and they'd run about 600 verses in an hour of meeting. And so Ed was a Bible guy, and he loved the Lord, loved right division. And we'd go out, and we'd eat lunch, and we'd talk. He wouldn't talk Bible. And he told me one time, he said, you know, we're just not used to people preaching like you preach. And I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you say it like that's the only way it could be. And we're just not used to that. I said, well, how do you want me to say it? He said, I'm not complaining. We're just kind of not used to that. We haven't heard that for a while, was what he said. And I said, well, you know, if I thought it was a different way than the way I'm saying it, I would say it that way. But I would still say it the way I thought it was, like I thought it was, because it's not me saying it, it's that book. You speak with all authority. And the authority doesn't come from you. I mean, God help you to think I'm an authority in anything. When I moved to Chicago, the lady that played the organ at North Shore Church, Beulah Peterson, had taught English in the public schools for years. After about a year and a half, Beulah said, come here, Jordan. And she set me down in the front pew after a morning meeting, and she says, I got this notebook of things you say I never heard before. I want you to explain them to me. And he had a notebook with two pages front and back of expressions that I used that she'd never heard before. The first one was tie rag on the bush. And I looked at her like, if you don't know what that means, I don't know how to explain it to you. You know, she went, and so I know that I'm not much of an authority in things, and I don't try to be, but I got a book that is. Okay? So that's where you are. And that's where Paul was exhorting Titus to go there, not push his own weight around, not say, Paul sent me, but say, this is what God said. And you don't do it by saying, I'm making an authority. You do it by teaching the doctrine. Because the truth will be the authority. The truth will do the work if you just preach it. You follow that? So go back to verse 11. Let's go down through this. The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men. Now, that's a real clear verse. How did the grace of God that brings salvation appear to all men? Well, that's what came through that special ministry and message committed to the Apostle Paul. You go through this timeline back here, and that the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. Jesus Christ back here. Come back with me to John chapter 1. Jesus Christ, the two words in that verse, that passage you need to look at very clearly. It's appeared to all men. That's something unique with the Apostle Paul. John chapter 1, verse 17, he says, "For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ." And you say, well, that's wonderful. Verse number 14, John 1, 14, "The Word was made flesh and dwell among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory even as the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." So when Jesus Christ came, He was full of God. He was God in human flesh. He was full of grace and truth, and you beheld the glory of God by seeing the grace and truth as it lived and demonstrated itself in the Lord Jesus Christ. But if you look back at verse 11, he says, "He came into His own, and His own received Him not." Who was His own? Yeah, look over at chapter 4, verse number 22. John chapter 4, verse number 22. Jesus talking to the woman at the well of Samaria, He says, "Ye worship, you know not what." You don't have an idea what you're doing when you're worshiping. "For salvation is of" who? You guys with that religion up there at Samaria don't have any. You're a bunch of ignorant, superstitious worshipers. You don't know what you're doing. Because salvation belongs down here in Jerusalem with the Jews. Well, when he says grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, who did it come to? It wasn't appearing for every man. It was appearing back here in time past when that middle wall of partition's up with Israel. But when you come to Paul, over the grace of God that appeared, that brings salvation, that appeared to every man, that's an appearing that for every man that comes specifically through that message given to the Apostle Paul. That's where the grace of God that appears brings salvation has appeared to every man. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2. 1 Timothy chapter number 2. If you ever want to know what the will of God is, people say, "I want to go do the will of God. Our church wants the will of God." We went through a thing back in the 90s, in the early 20th century, where all Christian ministries were shamed into humiliation if they didn't have a purpose statement. And you're going to go out and you got this all this seeker stuff. Well, you go out and you get the business model and you put it on the church, and a business model has to have a business plan, has to have a purpose statement. So your ministry needs a purpose statement. I always thought about that seeker church stuff. The Bible says no man seeks after God. So you're out here looking for people that don't exist. You literally set your church up to operate on the basis of seeking people that God says don't exist. Now, you can work that out any way you want to work it out. You obviously know I'm not a real fan of the seeker stuff, because why would I want to seek something that God said doesn't exist? If I got something into my church that God said didn't exist, I'd have something that's phony, not real. Well, I'll say amen. Okay. Now I feel better. I can move on. The will, people want a purpose. You want a purpose statement? You know what the will of God is? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse number 4. You can't miss that. God our Savior would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. You know what the will of God is? He'd have all lost people to come to faith in Christ so they could have the life that Christ performed at salvation. God wants lost people to get saved. He wants your kids to get saved. He wants your grandparents to get saved. He wants your neighbors to get saved. He wants your enemies to get saved. He wants people you know to pass out of death into life through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the will of God. You go to work on the mar and you say, "I'm going to work so I can make a living for my family." That's good. That's a good thing. But in your job, God wants people to have the opportunity to hear the gospel. You're there. You're a vehicle, an ambassador to do that. The will of God is that people be saved. How much of your life are you trying to do the will of God? I mean, if we went around the room tonight and asked you how many gospel tracts you got in your pocket. There was a time when you didn't walk, Christian people didn't go anywhere without gospel tracts. Now you can't get them to have them. Well, they just get bent in my pocket. You understand what I'm saying? People want to do the will of God. There's the will of God. Hard to figure it out. And come to the knowledge of the truth. That is, once they get saved, He wants them to have that life that they got when they trusted Christ to function in their life the way it's designed to function. So there's the purpose statement. Now verse number 4:5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself a ransom for what? For all. Now back here in Matthew chapter 20, he told his apostles, the Son of Man is going to give his life a ransom for many. Did you ever notice many isn't all and all isn't many? People arguing with the Calvinists about, well, did he die for everybody or did he die for just a few people? And the Calvinists run to Matthew 28 and said he died for many, and everybody says, oh, that many means all. And I read it, I said, not in the dictionary I ever read. You see, there's a dispensational issue there. By the way, you can't be a Calvinist and be a dispensationalist. You can't be a dispensationalist and be a Calvinist. I don't care who said they could. You say, well, what are you, Brother Jordan? I'm a neither nor. I'm neither a Calvinist nor an Arminian. I'm a Bible-believing dispensationalist. That's something entirely different, okay? But when he says he gave his life a ransom for all, notice the rest of it, to be testified in due time. That's not the consistent testimony of all the Scripture. There came a point in time when that truth began to be testified. When is that? Verse number 7. Whereunto I am ordained. Here's why I was ordained. A preacher, a teacher, an apostle. I speak the truth in Christ and lie not. And a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and verity. I was made a teacher and an apostle and a preacher of the Gentiles in order to reveal the truth that he has given his life a ransom for all men. The fact he was going to die as a ransom for Israel is back here. But the fact he's going to die as a ransom for everybody without any distinction, that appears here. So the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men through that ministry right there, Paul's ministry. You with me? Now, what appeared through Paul's ministry was grace. The grace of God appeared. God changed the operating system from law to grace with Paul's ministry. Come back with me, if you will, to Romans chapter number 3. Romans chapter 3. I'm already behind. Romans chapter number 3, verse 21. But now the righteousness of God, but now, right here, not time past, but now, right over here, the righteousness of God, what's the rest? Without the law. If you don't have that underlined, underline it. The righteousness of God without the law is manifest. How is the righteousness of God being made known in the dispensation of grace now? He's not using the law to manifest the righteousness of God. Being witnessed by the law and the prophets. You know what the law and the prophets said? You need something more than us. So God says, that's right, and here it is. There's grace. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there's no difference. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in His blood, to declare His righteousness for the remission of sins that are passed through the forbearance of God, to declare, I say, at this time His righteousness, that He might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. I mean, I read that, I say, any questions? I mean, that's so simple that a 6-year-old kid that flunked kindergarten could get that. And when people can't get it, it isn't because they couldn't get it, it's because they didn't want to get it. The next verse he says, where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? Nay, but by the law of faith. You ever hear anybody say, well, who saved you, Jesus or you? If you say you're saved by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ, then you saved yourself and you can boast. What's that verse say? He says, where is the boasting? It's excluded. How? By works? No, but by the law of faith. Faith is the only thing you can do without working. Chapter 4, verse 5, it says, to him that believes, to him that works not but believes. Believing isn't a work. I don't care how many theological books you read that say it is. In the Bible, believing is the only thing you can do without doing something that's a work. And you got to do something to get saved. But you have to, what must I do to be saved? believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You have to make a choice, a non-meritorious sense of perception, to put your faith and trust and your reliance and your dependence on what Jesus Christ did and rest in what He did. And resting ain't working, folks. Resting is resting. Resting is I quit working because I got the answer. But now the righteousness of God without the law, without any works, without any performance on your side, is manifested. You know what God, what Paul's ministry does? Paul comes along and he replaces the law with grace. He replaces Israel's ministry and program under law with a program of grace. And by the way, hold your hand here. Come over to Galatians chapter 5. I just got to get this verse in as a shot here, just so that you understand. Galatians 5, verse number 18. There are two verses that fascinate me in teaching these things. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 37, Paul says, "If any man think himself to be spiritual or a prophet, you think you're a preacher, you're speaking for God, you think you're being led of the Spirit of God, let him acknowledge that the things that I write unto you are the commandments of God." Any preacher, any Bible teacher, any saint led by the Spirit of God will acknowledge that Paul's writings are the commandments of God for him. So now you know what's leading people when they don't acknowledge that. Here's another one of those kind of... That verse is a blast, folks. That verse just puts it waist high right across the plate, slow pitch where you can see the seams. You can hit that ball out of the park. You can get it. Here's another one, Galatians 5:18. You know, you hear people say, "We're led of God to do this. We're led of God to do that." Only two times Paul ever talks about being led of the Spirit. And it's never any of that stuff you hear preachers talk about. Galatians 5:18. "But if ye be led of the Spirit, ye are not," what? The Spirit of God will never, in the dispensation of grace, lead anyone to put another person under the law. That's the law, big L, the law, little L. The big L law, that's the law of Moses. The little L is the law that you use when you interrelate with people. The law of Moses is, if you keep these commandments, I'll bless you. If you don't, I'll curse you. The little L, your law, is, if you live up to my expectations, I'll be happy with you. I'll be nice to you, and I'll coo and whisper in your ear. And if you don't, cold shoulder, rejection. You know that experience, don't you? You know it in your marriage. You know it with your children. You know it on your job. When somebody doesn't live up to your expectations, which are unrealistic to start with probably, because you wanted them to do something that they weren't capable of doing, you want them to be perfect to start with, and we already knew they were sinners and weren't going to be perfect, so you set them up to fail anyway. Why? Because you... Well, anyway. That's the law with little L. So either one it is, the Spirit of God never leads you to function that way. How do I know? I can read Galatians 5:18 and I can tell, okay? So God has replaced the law system with grace. You got Romans 3. Look at verse 24 because I want to be sure we understand what grace is. Galatians 3:24. "Being justified freely by His grace through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus." Romans 3:24. I said something else, didn't I? Romans 3:24, "Being justified, declared righteous by God, freely," didn't cost you anything, cost Him everything, "by His grace, through the redemption." Where does grace come from? Through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. People say grace means unmerited favor. Well, that's a kindergarten definition of it. That's okay. Grace is really what God is free to do for you through the finished work of Calvary. It's what God can give you as a gift through the redemption that's in Christ Jesus. justice. Everything that Jesus Christ won for you at Calvary, He gives it to you freely because the cross paid for it, you didn't. The cross won it, you didn't. The cross accomplished it, you didn't. And He gives it to you freely because you couldn't have done it anyway. That's grace. That's wonderful. Come over to chapter 8, verse 32. Romans chapter 8, verse 32. He that spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for us all, how shall He not with Him also freely give us what? All things. If anybody ever asks you what does it mean to be complete in Christ, read them that verse. Okay? He gives us all things. Read back up through the passage and see what all those things are, those all spiritual blessings that He's accomplished. And He gives them to us freely. And the argument of the verse is that if He gave up His Son, spared not His own Son, but delivered Him up for it, if He gave the greatest thing He possessed, how will He not with Him also give you all things? That's God's grace. That's the inexhaustible, no strings attached, abundant, abounding grace. I saw a book in the bookstore one time, not long ago, God's Inexhaustible Grace for an Exhausted World. I thought, that's a great title. I'm not going to pay $25 to buy the book, but I'll steal the title. And that's it. The grace of God, all that God is free to do for you through the finished work of Christ, has been revealed through the ministry committed to Paul. The final revelation of all that God's accomplished is there in Paul's epistles. You come to Paul, you've come to some high ground. Now go back and watch what it does in Titus. Because right here, when you begin to preach about the grace of God, what does Romans 6 tell you? After you finish telling them where sin abounds, grace did much more abound. And your flesh doesn't like that. You know that? We don't like that. The next thing he says, what shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? You know that passage. God forbid. When you preach about God's grace, people are going to think about it that way. So I want you to look at what he says here, Titus 2, verse 11. This inexhaustible grace of God for an exhausted world is manifested today. It's set forth today. It's no strings attached love in Christ is yours. He put away sin by the sacrifice of Himself. And look at what it does. Teaching us. Don't you love that? Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. You see what the grace of God does when you understand it and appreciate it for what it is? It instructs you. It teaches you. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing. There's the renewed hope and glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave Himself for us that He might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto Himself, what? A peculiar people, zealous of good works. Back here under the law, go back with me to Exodus 19. Back under the law, God taught Israel to be a peculiar people. That's what the law was for in Israel's program, was to teach them to be a peculiar, separated, holy, obviously belonging to God, people. Exodus chapter 19, verse 5. Now therefore, if you will obey My voice indeed and keep My covenant, then you should be a peculiar treasure unto Me above all people. God's desire was to make the nation Israel. The word peculiar doesn't mean strange and odd kind of thing. That's not the idea there. Words change their meaning. In my lifetime, that word has changed its meaning. Originally, when I was young, that word, if you looked it up in a Webster's dictionary, the first definition of the word peculiar means to belong to. That book is peculiarly Carol's. That means a strange book. It means it belongs to her particularly. But the words change now. But you shouldn't be surprised about that. I mean, we used to say we're going to go have a gay old time. Well, you don't say that now. You know, 2 weeks ago they had a big gay time down in Chicago. They called it the Gay Pride Parade. They weren't down there having a good time. They were down there flaunting their iniquity. So the word gay changes, you know. So you have to, you know, think about now we don our gay apparel. Well, you understand, the words have changed their meaning. So the word peculiar carries the idea of belonging to. Here's what people that belong, here's a nation that belongs to Jehovah, and that's what they look like. Now, how were they to be made a peculiar people? If you keep my covenant, then, you see that if then? If you meet these conditions, then this is the reality. That's law. That's how the law works. Conditional blessing. Based on your performance. So the law was used back here to make Israel his people. I want you to go back and look at Titus because it's different for us. Titus chapter 2 verse 14. Who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people. He makes us the peculiar people himself. He doesn't say, I'll make you a peculiar people if you do something. He said, I redeemed you and purified you and made you that. You see the difference in that? That's the difference between law and grace. Law says, if you do it, I'll make you that. Grace says, here's what I made you. It's all up front. There, it's yours. And you know what I did when I saved you? I made you a peculiar person. You are a real oddball if you live in the world and you've been, what verse 14 says, you've been redeemed from all iniquity and purified. You are a weird looking dude to the world. You say, why? Because verse 12 says that grace that does that teaches you something. Now look back at verse 12. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly. Does that sound like God's grace is going to change things in your life? It's going to teach you that there are some things that you deny access to your life. It's going to teach you, here are some things you put in your life. Here's what your life looks like. That's not what your life looks like. That isn't who you are. This is who you are. Now, when I read that, I say to myself two things. I say, number one, grace is going to change some things in my life. It teaches me immediately it's going to change some things. You know what it tells me? He put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. So what does that teach me about sin in my life? What did he already do with it? Put it away. So how long does it take me to understand that if he did that, what should I do? I should do the same thing he did, shouldn't I? I should deny it. Then he gave me his life. So if I realize that, what would that teach me? That's not who I am. This is who I am. You see, this isn't brain surgery here. One, it teaches you that it's going to change your life. Number two, the law isn't going to do that for you. You say where he says, well, the law isn't going to do it. Why isn't the law going to do that? Hold your hand and come with me to Romans 8. You might as well keep holding Romans. Because this stuff back here in Romans is foundational. This is the foundation your Christian life lives on. I don't care what kind of superstructure you build on that. I don't care how high in the heavenlies you go in your understanding, it's all built on the cross work and the foundation of God's grace, as is revealed in the book of Romans. Romans chapter 8, verse 3. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh. Now who's got flesh? You. So the law's weak, it couldn't do something because you couldn't do it. It made demands you couldn't keep. It set standards you couldn't meet. It didn't have the ability to change you because it required you to change you. So what Titus 2 verse 11, 12 is talking about is what grace teaches. The law can't do it. So what's grace teach? Denying ungodliness and worldly lust. Deny it. That's not who I am. I have a new identity. I've been made a new creature in Christ. I've been purified and redeemed. And when I see these things, the ungodliness, ungodly. Anything that's against God. I think of Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. I hear people talk about Genesis and all this stuff, and I think there's a lot of really good sermons wasted on Genesis. The first chapter of Genesis was not written in the Bible to prove how old the earth is. And everybody you see trying to make a case and an argument in a ministry about the age of the earth out of Genesis chapter 1 is illegitimately using the chapter. Got deathly quiet, I can hear the air conditioner. There's more information about the age of the earth and about creation in the book of Job and the book of Isaiah than in Genesis. Now, I don't believe in evolution. Why? Because it says in the beginning God created. End of discussion, we can move on. You say, but unbelievers, listen, no unbeliever is ever going to be anything but an unbeliever based on that kind of argument. That isn't what's going to win them. Because when people read Genesis, in the beginning God created heaven, there's two ways to read that verse. In the beginning God created, and the other is in the beginning me, I created. That's the only two choices you have. We're going to produce change in your life. You've got two choices. You've got law and you've got grace. That's all the choices there are. You can do it or God can do it. When he said, in the beginning, I created. That's what everybody says. But when you say, I'm in control. You know what you're saying? You've got to create your own world. Now listen to me. That means you have to go out in your life and create your own value. You have to go out and vindicate and validate your reason for existence. Your worth, your purpose. You have to go out and do all that for yourself because you're being the one that created. But when it says in the beginning, God created. Now think about that. What did God do? He created the earth. He created a garden. He created some work to do in the garden, and then he created man and woman and put them in the garden and said, go to work. Did they create the work? He put it there before them. Did they create the trees? He put them there. All they had to do was go out and enjoy what he already created. You know what God did? He demonstrated how he operates, how he desires to operate. That's grace. That's here's the provision. I did it. It's yours. Go enjoy it. Here's how to enjoy it. Do you follow that? He did it in two areas, work and relationships. That's what we do. We go out and use our work and our relationships to try to create our own worth, to validate our existence, to give purpose, to seek love, to seek rescue and freedom. Me created it, that's law living. Little L, but law nonetheless. In the beginning, God created. That's grace living. Denying ungodliness. To deny ungodliness. Now, there's a whole lot of doctrinal stuff about that, but the bottom line of it is to deny ungodliness is just to say, I'm gonna deny rebellion against what God is doing in my life. I'm not going to live on the basis of me being responsible to set up and to choose. I'm going to live on the basis of God being the provider and the giver and the worldly lust. Adam and Eve became addicted to self-gratification. It was desired. And they became addicted to satisfying their own desires. You know, that's the basis of what sin is. Paul says, the grace of God teaches you to deny. You know the problem going out and trying to gratify your own self? The Bible says there's pleasure in sin. You know that verse, Hebrews 11? Everybody says, woo-hoo! But then it says, for a season. Payday someday. It don't last. And what it is a cheap gratification. And your flesh loves that. Ephesians 4:19, he says that they've given themselves over to lasciviousness, to work all uncleanness with greediness. Your flesh is a hog. It wants more. Give me more. Give me more. Because that's the way sin is. The wage of sin is death. When sin is conceived, it brings forth death. And you go out there and you seek the gratification. You're going to do it your way. And you're going to create your own gratification. And it satisfies. It titillates. It makes you happy. And then you go back next time and it doesn't make you as happy next time. In fact, it doesn't make you happy at all. And you got to go deeper into it. You got to do something else. And that's the progression of sin. And Paul says what grace teaches you is you're through with all of that. That isn't who you are. Don't tell me the grace of God won't make a difference in your life. Understanding who you are in Christ, what the grace of God says, that isn't you. So why in the world would you go out and live like somebody you aren't? Well, why do you? You're having a dumb, stupid moment. Sure, that's what it is. Denying ungodliness and worldly lust. Looking at my identity in Christ and said, that's not who I am. Now, when you deny ungodliness and worldly lust, what that means is you accept as true what the grace of God say did for you. He freely gave us all things. The moment you trust Christ, He puts you into Christ. You don't even know about it yet, and God blesses you with all these things. Who of God has made unto us wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption? Just start with them. I mean, that's enough to get you through. God made him wisdom, righteousness, sanctification, purpose, meaning in life, and redemption, freedom. You seek, you spend your life seeking for things God already gave you. We spend life striving, working, seeking, longing, desperately in pursuing approval and love and worth and validation and meaning and significance and freedom from fear and freedom from guilt and freedom from shame and freedom from failure and freedom from sin and its bondage. And we seek all of that. Desperately. In a thousand places and people that are infinitely smaller than the Lord Jesus Christ. And God said, I gave all of that to you and more in Him. And it's already yours. And denying ungodliness and worldly lust is to say, listen, the reality of my identity right now is that I am accepted in the Beloved. I am made perfect in His Son. And it is the current, present reality of my identity. Instantly, this moment, I have this perfect place in Christ Jesus. And that enables me to recognize anything in my life that is inconsistent with that identity and say to that, you aren't me, you don't belong in my life, get out! That's what he means in Colossians 3. And he says, mortify therefore the deeds of the flesh. Go find those suckers and stomp them out. Deal ruthlessly with sin in your life. Because that's the sin that put Christ on the cross. Every time you go out and you see a sin in your life, if you look at it and say, that sin is what killed my Savior, you'll quit thinking about it quite so well. Yeah. You live in a consciousness of your true identity. and you see those things in your life and you think about them the way God thinks about them, and you look at that failure and that sin and that rebellion and that striving for acceptance and pride, and you say, that's what Jesus Christ died to put away. That'll help you understand denying ungodliness. Don't tell me the grace of God won't teach you to change your life. That's what it's about. But what it teaches you is you're not changing to get to be somebody. You're changing because you are somebody. Okay? That you might live soberly, righteously, and godly. Now the living part is the walk. I got rid of that. I'm going to put that off, put this on. Here's where the Word works effectually in you that believe. Here's, you see, the Christian life is not a passive, I'm going to sit here and just see what happens kind of life. It's an active participation of the believer living by faith in the identity God has given you in Christ. You don't have to do anything to get that identity. He did it all for you. And one of the things He gave you in the present reality of your identity is He gave you His life. And that life teaches you to live soberly. Romans 12:3, be sober-minded. Think not of yourself more highly than you ought to think. Have reality thinking. Law thinking is unrealistic expectations. You're expecting yourself or others to be perfect when they can't, and then you nail them when they don't. Leads to misery. Grace thinking is, I can't, He can, in Him I have everything God has for me. And it's His life and His victory and His work that I stand in. And what I need to do, I need to know it, understand it, and have His mind renew my mind and find out what it is He's doing. And you know what you do is you find out that when He saved you, He didn't save you just to keep you out of hell. That's a pretty good deal. But He saved you for more than that. He's got this wonderful purpose for us. Verse 13, that blessed hope and glorious appearing of the great God. There's something future out there in the future I look forward to. And I realize it's out there, and I see what He's going to do with me out there, and I have the promise of the life that now is and that which is to come. But that verse 12 says you're going to live that way in this present world. I'm going to live right now with that in view. I'm going to have an eternal perspective. You're going to get some education here. He's teaching you. You're going to get some edifying. He calls it godly edifying. You're going to be built up in an understanding, and that's going to begin to renew your mind, form Christ's life in you. And then it's just His life. And so it's you're living soberly, righteously. Philippians 1:11, he says, being filled with the fruits of righteousness. I'm not doing this to get righteous. He already gave me righteousness, and that righteousness bears fruit in my life. Being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ under the glory and praise of God. He wants to put His Son, He has put His Son in your life. He wants His Son to be living through your life. As you walk by faith in an understanding of His Word, who He's made you in Christ and how it operates, He wants you to take that grace and bring it into the details of your life so that people can look at your life and Jesus Christ can be glorified. They can look at the attitudes and actions that you have and they say, there's something weird about that guy. He don't fit in the world I live in. I'm a stranger and a foreigner. That's right. You see, our life bearing those fruits of who God's made us in Christ. How'd you get righteous? In Him. He's made unto us righteousness. I don't have to go do something to be righteous. He made me righteous. But that bears fruit. Comes into my life. Soberly, righteously, and godly. I can have God's mind. To me, the greatest thing about godliness, it's not simply that I can think like God thinks. But Jeremiah chapter 9, verse 24, he says, let the rich man, don't let him glory in his riches, the wise man in his wisdom. But let me tell you what to glory in. Glory in these things. And he talks about what he does. And glory, he literally says, glory in the things that I delight in. You know what the high mark of the Christian life is? When you can have the delight in your soul about the things that your Father has delight in. Psalm 40, when Jesus came, quoted in Hebrews 10, came into the world and said, "A body is not prepared for me," and He came in. Psalm 40, it says, I delight to do thy will. When that delighting heart of Christ lives in you. Now, that comes because you understand what the Father's will is. But at every level that you understand it and you delight in, I'm delighting in what the Father's doing. I'm delighting in what He's accomplishing, His purpose. I've got that eternal point of view. That transforms you. That changes you. That makes life different. That's bringing grace into your life. Now, if you go back to Romans chapter 8, and we'll finish that verse. We read verse 3. Now, let me just read verse 4. Romans 8, verse 4. Start in verse 3. "For what the law could not do, and that it was weak through the flesh, God sending His Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh." Why did He do it? "That the righteousness of the law," all the things, the right actions that the law demanded, "might be fulfilled," notice, "in us." I'm glad He didn't say "by me." He said "in me." There's a life in me that causes these things to happen out of me, not because there's a rule to keep, but there's a life to live. "Who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." And then He goes on in verse 5 to 13 to tell you what it means to walk after the flesh and after the Spirit. When you walk after the flesh, you mind the things of the flesh. When you walk after the Spirit, you mind the things of the Spirit. Where do you find the things of the Spirit? You find them in the Word of God, rightly divided. You find them in what God's doing in Christ Jesus today. You find them in who God's made you in Christ. And when you put your mind on that, Rick talked last night about set your affection on things above. You know, seek those things above. Set your affection on those things. When you do that, when you become occupied with Him and what He's accomplished, you know what happens? You ever sing that song, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in His wonderful face, and the things of this earth grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace"? Years ago, when I worked at the rescue mission in Mobile, there was a preacher who'd been there, a guy that had been there some years before I was there. And he'd moved over to New Orleans, and he became what was known as the chaplain of Bourbon Street. His name was Bob Harrington. And he set up a ministry on Bourbon Street, and he had a little storefront. And he would put up a, back then you were playing records, Brother Marvin can remember these days, and he'd play gospel records at the door, and then he'd go out past tracks. And there's a dude ran a house of ill repute on the second floor of that establishment. And he came down there to him. Bob told me, he said, he came down there to him one day and he offered him. He said, now preacher, I'll give you $1,000 if you'll quit playing them records. He said, well, why do you want me to quit playing the records? He said, you're running the business. It's a little bit difficult for some old country boy to come into town and shack up with some prostitute listening to "Oh, How I Love Jesus," and then "There's Power in the Blood. Would you be free from the power of," you know, a little hard, messing up the dude's business. And I've always thought about that in the context of believers. It's far more difficult to live below the snake line when your mind is in the heavenlies in Christ and your heart's fixed on what He's done. When you mix law and grace, you weaken law. Because the law doesn't say you can drive 60 in a 55 mile an hour zone because we're going to give you 5. The law is an unflexible, unbending code of righteousness. And when you mix it with grace, you say, well, maybe it won't be that bad. So when you mix law and grace, you weaken the law. But the worst in that, you harden grace, because you make grace, instead of that no strings attached, unbounding love, you begin to put little, well, yeah, but you better nots on it. And that's why. You see, we don't fear the law. What we fear is our flesh. And Paul says, the love of Christ constraineth me. You know that passage? Look over there, 2 Corinthians 5. We'll quit with this one and one more. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. Watch how he says this. For the love of Christ constraineth us. Well, why is the love of Christ going to pick you up and carry you along? How is it that the love of Christ is going to be an inner compulsion that constrains you to deny ungodliness and worldly lust and to live soberly? Why is it that way? Because, he's going to tell you why. You want the love of Christ to constrain you? That's not your love for Him, that's His love for you. Because we thus judge. I think a certain way. I have a mindset that is controlled by the love and grace of God. And here's how I think about it. That if one died for all, it was because everybody was dead. And that He died for everybody so that those of us that trust Him might not live unto themselves. It's going to live like we were living, but we could live unto Him. He did all this to transform us. That's what the grace of God teaches you. And when it teaches you, you see what it does? It compels you. It constrains you. I've used the illustration for years. My wife is about 5 foot two. I'm 5'9". When we were dating, and even after we were engaged, I'd go over to her mom and dad's house, and we'd stand out on the front porch and say goodbye, and I'd stand on the bottom step, and she'd stand on the top step because it allowed us to be eye to eye. Now, there were other things that allowed us to be close to it, too, which were more important than eye to eye, but she would say, please take me away. And one day I put my arms around her and I stepped up and I picked her up, her feet dangling, and I carried her off into a life of 45 years of absolute marriage bliss. One day the Lord Jesus Christ came along and put everlasting arms of love around you and picked you up, and with your feet dangling in the air, walked off across the bowels of heaven for an eternity of bliss. And that constraining love comes into your life when you think that way. Now look over at chapter 10. Let me give you an illustration. You ever have any bad thoughts? Well, obviously some of you do. I had a fellow come and sit down with me not too long ago. He says, Brother Jordan, I got to talk to you. I'm not sure what's going on in my life. But I'm having these terrible thoughts, really bad thoughts. He began to tell me. I said, I don't want to hear any more of them. I don't. Talking about your problems don't solve your problems, because if they did, you wouldn't be talking to me. If talking about your problems solved your problems, they'd be solved. Talking about your problems only talks about your sin. Talking about the answer is what solves your problems. So I didn't need to hear all this. He says, I don't see how anybody that's saved could think those thoughts. I don't see how I could possibly be a child of God thinking like that. You ever been there? You ever let your conduct, your failures, your thoughts condemn you? I know you have. So you can put the bravado out for everybody else, but when it comes to laying your head on your pillow and looking at your life for who you are, that happens. I said, I want you to read me a verse. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. Casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Now tell me something. Whose obedience does that verse focus on? Look at it. For years I read that verse different than that. I said, bring every thought into captivity to obedience to Christ. I need to make my thinking conform to His thinking. Because I'd done tried that and failed. That says bring your thinking into captivity to His obedience. Now what's His obedience? By one man's disobedience we were all made sinners. By one man's obedience we were made righteous. When did that happen? Philippians 2 verse 8 says He was obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. You know how Jesus Christ went to the Calvary? Husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave Himself for it. How did He love the church? He loved the church according to the will of His Father. He was obedient to His Father's will. For the joy that was set before Him, He endured the cross, despising the shame. He understood what the Father was going to accomplish through His death. And because that meant more to Him, pleasing His Father, delighting in what His Father delighted in, He said, this is nothing compared to that. You see, it's not your obedience that you have to focus on, because your obedience will come up short. It's His obedience that we focus on. For He's done it for us. And that teaches us. Let's live in that identity. You want to bring grace into life? First, you've got to understand what grace is. Now listen, at every point in your life, and I get amused sometimes at people. They say, well, you have to get to this third level of edification before you're in. And I think, wait a minute, what about the poor dude back down at number one just trying to get up to number three? Well, he isn't there yet. In other words, you can't really bring grace into your life till you get this. No. Let me give you good news. Wherever you are tonight, in Christ, everything God will ever have for you, you already possess. The enjoyment, the usefulness, the ability to bring it into your life, into your experience, and to become skilled in the use of it is going to be determined by your ability to learn it and appropriate it by faith. First, you got to know it. But every step of the way that you learn, every time you learn more about God's grace, you don't have to wait till you get a super status up here. You can take right then and bring God's grace into your life at that level of maturity that you've reached. You follow that? It's sort of like God gave you this big gift box. There's the box, the gift. And you can look at it and say, ain't that wonderful? Or you can go over and say, well, those are pretty bows, but I want to know what's in it. Tear it apart and start digging in. Now, some people give you the idea that He gave you this big gift box and that you need to come along and start putting stuff in it. But God already put everything in the box He ever wants you to have. What you need to do is learn what's in it. That's called godly edifying. Find out what it is. And then allow that truth to effectually work in you as you walk by faith in the reality of that being your possession. And see it come into the experience of your life. You see, you appropriate things into your life first by knowing about them and then by reckoning them to be true. You don't appropriate them by doing it yourself because you don't earn it. You take what God already gave you. That's why two times in Colossians that word complete in Christ, the word complete is used. One in chapter 2, verse 10, where He says, you're complete in Him, which is the head of all principality and power. The top thing that God's going to do is all in Christ. And everything up to the the pinnacle of what he's doing is yours in him. Then he says Epaphroditus prayed for them, labored fervently in prayer, that they might stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. That they would bring that grace into their life, into their experience, into their understanding, and appropriate it into their life. When you realize God's going to treat you like a son or a daughter, you get excited. If a stranger came to your house tonight, or when you get home, not tonight. Somebody you've never seen before came in, just opened the door, walked in, came in, sat down at the kitchen table and looked around, went over to the refrigerator and got out roll of round steak, cut him off a couple pieces and took a piece of bread and some cheese and made him a little mayonnaise on it, made him a sandwich, got him a Dr. Pepper and sat down there and started eating. What would you do? You say, what are you doing? I don't know you. Who are you? Get out of my house. If you don't, I'm going to call the cops. Well, I'll take the cops too long. Let me get the gun. You'd throw them out. But if that same stranger came to your house with your son, came in the front door with your son arm in arm, good buddies, and he came into your house and sat down at your table, how would you treat him then? Wouldn't you treat him like a son? See, you're not a stranger in the family. You've been accepted in the beloved. That's where your identity is. What you need to do is learn to live in the reality of who you are. And find out what the Father's doing in his son. And the more you know about it, you know what? The more you have his mind. And that's what edification, that's what that godly edification is about. That's what that form of sound words in Paul's epistles is about, to bring you through and understand, matriculate you through and understand. But it's not just an academic exercise. It's designed to give you his life, his thinking, so that it can live in all the details of your life. So that the message you preach can be authenticated and put on display by the transforming power of his grace in your life. When you appropriate into your life, into your experience, the reality of that true, complete identity that you already possess in Christ Jesus. And as you recognize and identify as unworthy of that identity, things, and you put them off. You've denied ungodliness. You've lived soberly, righteously, and godly. You'll find yourself looking for that blessed hope. Now, Wednesday night, we're going to talk about that. Looking out there to it. Because now you get that understanding of it. But friend, the way you bring the grace of God into life is by bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. It's his obedience. It's him. And it's the present reality of who he's made us. And when you walk by faith in every detail of your life as the saint of the Most High God that he made you in his Son, he gave his life for you at Calvary, so he could give his life to you when you trusted him. So he could live his life through you day by day as you live by faith in an understanding of his word to you. And his word works effectually in you that believe. Now it took me an hour and 10 minutes to tell you all that. And Paul just said, the grace of God has appeared to salvation, bringeth salvation to all men, hath appeared to all men. Teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly and righteously and godly in this present world, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I told you he encapsulized it. I can stretch it out. But that's the reality. That's why this is worth standing for, worth having living in your live in you and live in your life and your ministry. You're here tonight wherever you are. If you've never trusted Christ, this is not in religion. It's not in you making yourself what you can accomplish, what you can do to validate, to authenticate, to justify your existence. How much you can accumulate, what you can become. It's got nothing to do with your past, your present, or your future, or your religious. It has to do with what God did for you at Calvary. And you can trust Him. He'll save you. Put away your sin and give you His life. Because He did it for you. And my Christian friend, as you received Him, so walk ye in Him. He didn't change the rules. He just made it more and more of grace. And He gives you the privilege. I tell our folks all the time that we got people in our city. We had a guy just died. He was 90-something years old, 90, 91, 92 years old. Mary West died. She was 91 years old. She'd been saved longer than most everybody else in the church been alive. Then we got people been saved just 2 months. She didn't have one more thing in Christ than the guy that had been saved 2 months was, but she'd had a lot longer to find out about it, grow in it. And that's just the difference. Bring it into your life. Get your nose in that book. Learn the truth of who God is. Let that book consume you. Give attendance to reading, to the intake of the Scripture. That's what a meeting like this is for, to teach you how to do that, encourage you how to do it. And let it transform your life for God's glory. Don't just be a grace believer that knows about it. Bring it into your experience, in the details of your life. That's what it's designed for. Amen. Father, we thank You tonight for our Savior. Our hearts long to be able to say that we're just satisfied with Him. But we know we really can't honestly do that because we see so much in ourselves that aren't satisfied only with Him because we turn into our own way so often. But we rejoice that You're completely satisfied with Him. And that what He's done, not what we do, is the issue. Who He is, not who we are, is the issue. And that our identity is firmly and eternally fixed in Him. And that it's His life that lives through us as we trust Your Word, as we depend on Your Word that gives our life into His hands to be used for His glory. We thank You for that in His name. Amen. We're going to sing a song.